Basically, when I think about metastatic breast cancer and the patients I work with, I really think about it as a roller coaster of emotions. And I think it's often a really long journey, and there are points in time where it can feel really comfortable and you feel like you've found a way to make this part of your normal life, and other times when I think it can feel much more distressing. And some of the things that the common themes that I find come up with my patients who are living with metastatic breast cancer are the things I wanted to address today, really the common challenges and to some basic coping strategies for how to manage that. And the first one, I think, is really about feeling isolated. And, you know, up here I just said basically seek support either individually or in a group setting. But I think sometimes it can feel very isolating living with metastatic breast cancer because there's a lack of understanding about what that is and how it's different from early stage breast cancer, which I think is widely understood. And I think it can feel really frustrating, and it's important to find ways to connect with other people who understand what it is to live with this illness every day. And I personally, I think one of the best ways to do that is to connect with a support group, because I think you can find other people who inspire you and who you feel like can help you feel comfortable in the times that are more rocky for you, and you can also give support to people who might be struggling when you're feeling better. Another way is by attending conferences like this, where you can just look out and see that there are so many other people who are sharing this experience with you. And in terms of individually, I think it's really helpful to have an individual social worker, someone that you're seeing regularly, or a therapist in the community, because I find often, and this sort of ties in nicely with what Lita said about palliative care, often people don't connect with someone until they're at a crisis point in their illness. And it's a really hard time to build a relationship. So I think meeting someone early on, the earlier the better, you establish that relationship, you get connected with them, and then it's easier to access that support when things are more challenging. Another challenge, of course, as I'm sure many of you know, is anxiety. Feelings of anxiety when you're living with metastatic breast cancer are completely normal. It's important to have some coping strategies that can help you deal with some of the times that I think are particularly anxiety-provoking, scan times, disease progression, and I think I often talk with people about some basic go-to techniques that can help you manage increased anxiety. And some of these, you know, some of these you may already be using, but meditation, mindfulness, I talk a lot with people about the value of some of these things, and they may not be things that work for you, but then some of the other things on the list, exercise, journaling, education about your illness can feel really empowering and help decrease anxiety, spirituality, if that's important to you. But really, all of these things are geared towards helping you regain a sense of control over what you're feeling emotionally, because anxiety really does come from feeling out of control, and sometimes finding ways to take back some of that control really helps to decrease the anxiety. Fear is another common challenge. Fear about the unknown is really common and can feel overwhelming, and it's important to allow yourself to feel these feelings. I think often I hear from patients that they're afraid of what will happen when they progress and how will they be able to adjust to another treatment change or to side effects if they're worse than the side effects they're experiencing right now. And you know what I often say is if you keep sweeping your fears under the rug, you'll eventually trip on them. But if you take each one out every time you feel it and address it head on, it sometimes feels a lot more comforting. And one of the ways to do that is to talk with your team about what you're afraid of. I think if you're afraid about particular side effects, if you're afraid of what it might be like when things get worse or your disease progresses to certain parts of your body, just addressing that with your team and having them tell you what that might be like can feel really comforting, because often what you imagine and the anticipatory anxiety is much worse than what it really is. Anger is another common challenge that I think lots of patients face. It's normal to feel angry that this happened to you, and it's normal to feel that at different points during this journey. But also, I really want people to be mindful of what the anger that they're experiencing looks like. Because, like I said, it's normal to feel it at different points in time, but if you find that you're incredibly rageful or that the anger isn't really going away, I think it's important to explore, because sometimes anger is really a cover for sadness. I think it's easier to feel angry than it is to feel sad, and it's easier to show anger to other people. So really having an opportunity to explore that is another way to help avoid it. And this is something else that can be done, you know, it can be individually, it can be done with people in your life, but it's important to really look at it. And this next slide is about the stages of grief. I don't know if any of you are familiar with it, but Elizabeth Kubler-Ross, who was a Swiss-American psychiatrist, who did a lot of her work, was focused on death and dying with dignity. And she came up with this idea that people who know they have a life-limiting illness or are facing death really go through this cycle of grief. And it starts at the very beginning, when you first know it. But the stages are denial, you know, not being able to accept. I'm sure some of you felt that this has actually happened or that you're living with this. Anger, being angry that it happened to you. Bargaining, you know, I'll change everything about my eating habits today, and maybe that will make it go away. I'll exercise because I've been putting that off. Depression, which is normal, to feel really sad that this has happened and to not know how you're going to keep moving forward with your life. And lastly, acceptance. And I put up the circular structure because I think that people are often in going back and forth between the stages throughout this entire journey. And just being aware of that, I think, can help you better understand the emotions that you're feeling. And a lot of times, you know, people can get into a place of acceptance in terms of just accepting the treatment that they're on, learning to make their lives feel somewhat normal, and then you might hit a patch of, you know, where you're back in the anger and you're not really sure why. You thought you dealt with that and left it behind. But the stages of grief aren't linear. I think they're circular and they often don't go in the order that we expect. So it's important just to be aware of this and to give yourself permission to be feeling some of these things. I think another one of the big challenges is managing long-term relationships. And, you know, when I say long-term relationships, I think that can be a variety of different relationships in your life. It can be a relationship with a partner. It can be a relationship with a family member. It can be a relationship with a friend. And often I hear a patient say that it's really challenging to manage this illness in the context of those relationships because it starts to feel like it creates some tension. And it's important to find ways to nurture these relationships so that they don't become strained or another loss for you. And one way to do this, I think, is to keep communication open, which I know is really hard when you're in the middle of coping with your diagnosis and it feels very much like it's just happening to you. But oftentimes these people in your life feel like it's happening to them too. And really being able to talk about that, I think, goes a long way towards keeping the relationship intact. I also think it's important to encourage people like this in your life to have their own support. And so that they have a place where they can really talk about how this is for them so that you don't feel like you're trying to support them when you're dealing with this happening to you. And I think creative intimacy, which probably seems like a strange combination of words, but I was trying to think of a way to really help people understand that I think it's important to find creative ways to not let cancer become the focus all the time of these relationships, which is really hard when you're living with it every day, especially I think as a patient. And, you know, over the years I've heard from patients different ways that they do this. Sometimes I think it's about identifying really very specifically cancer-free times, whether that's, you know, if you're going away for the weekend or if you have plans with a friend to do something fun, really deciding that this is not going to be a time when you're focusing on your illness. And it also gives you a break from having to think about it so much and really making the cancer topic off limit. I think gives you an opportunity to talk about some of the other things, which can feel nice and like a little bit of normalcy for you. And things might not ever be the way that they were in these relationships before this happened, but I think sometimes some of these things that you do can actually make them a little better. So it's worth exploring how to take care of these relationships. Appearance, which I know is a huge challenge for many of you, and something that is constantly changing what that means for you. Sometimes it means hair loss if you're on a treatment where that's a side effect. Sometimes I think it can mean, you know, skin discoloration, all sorts of other things. The hardest part about appearance, I think, is that it takes away your ability and your control over not sharing the information with other people who may not be important people in your life, acquaintances who notice that you don't have hair and maybe start asking questions that you don't feel comfortable answering. And some of the ways I think to cope with that, taking time for yourself, finding ways to make yourself feel more comfortable with the changes in your appearance. You know, I put down here participating in the Look Good, Feel Better workshop, which is really focused, I think, a lot on hair loss and how to make yourself feel like you look good when you're not feeling so great. But also, I think another way to make yourself feel more comfortable with it is to really think about how you want to manage some of the uninvited questions that might come up that really stir something up for you. And there are lots of different ways to do this and creative ways to sort of set limits around what's okay for people to ask or how you want to respond to it. And I think it's important to think through how you want to be in control of that information, because again, having control over some things when you feel like you've lost so much control can really be empowering. Another challenge, finding purpose and building structure. I think a lot of metastatic breast cancer patients aren't working. I know some are, but usually your life has changed in a way in terms of your day-to-day living, and many of the people in your life are continuing on in the same way that they were before. And so I think it can feel really lonely, and it can feel like you don't really have a purpose or something to talk about with the other people in your life when they're talking about normal work problems and stressors. And I think it's so important to create a sense of structure. You know, even if you don't have a time that you need to get up every day and you don't have somewhere you need to be, putting yourself on some kind of a schedule actually really decreases the feelings of depression. You know, I know it sounds silly, but just making a plan that you're going to be up every day at 8 o'clock, even if you're exhausted, and you're going to take a shower, and you're going to get dressed, and maybe you're just going to go get the mail. But making yourself do that starts to make you feel more normal, and I think it helps you just not to fall into a rut of really being more depressed. Setting some short and long-term goals is a way to find purpose. Those can be goals for things that you want to accomplish in your life. They can be goals just for you know, things you want to see, and finding something creative to do. I mean, I've had patients tell me that, you know, because of their treatment schedules and the way they feel, they can't work anymore, but they've always really wanted to read through a certain list of books. And sometimes that's not possible if you're, you know, if you're having trouble with some cognitive issues because of your treatment. But there are other things. Maybe you enjoy cooking and you want to find a way to still make that a part of your daily life. And you have to be creative with it, because you might not feel well, for instance, at the dinner time hour, but maybe you want to make a meal. I had a patient tell me once that she gets up every day and makes dinner in the morning. That's when she feels the best, and then she puts it away. But it's something that makes her feel like she's doing something else. And I think that's also helpful when you're part of a family structure, and maybe it feels like you don't know what your role in that family is anymore. So really thinking through what kinds of things might help you to create a sense of purpose and structure in your day-to-day life. Another common challenge is really managing information with children. And it doesn't have to be your own children. It can be nieces, nephews, grandchildren. But it's something that I often hear from patients, because people can live with metastatic breast cancer for a number of years, and often do, that sometimes what they said or the discussions that they had with children at the beginning, they never go back and revisit those discussions. And obviously, with the changing developmental stages of kids, it's important to have the conversations again and to revisit them and what their understanding is of what's going on. Open communication is really helpful. I think letting children know that you're going to be honest with them about your illness, and that you're going to, you know, that they, for instance, I often will say to people when they first find this out, a good thing to say to a child is, you know, you don't have to be worried right now, but if there's a time when I feel like you do really need to be worried, I'll let you know that. Because often kids are carrying around the worry that you're hiding information from them. And they're incredibly perceptive, and again, like adults do, they often are imagining the worst when they think that something's being kept from them. So giving them really a sense of security around your willingness to be open is comforting. Share information with teachers and counselors, coaches, people that are important in children's lives, because they might be noticing something very different about your child, and this helps them understand why that might be happening so that they can keep you informed. And lastly, in case any of you aren't aware, we do have these resources here at Dana-Farber called Kid Packs, and also some books on cancer in the family, which is a really helpful guide for how to manage communicating about your illness with children. And those are available at the Blum Resource Center on the first floor of the Yockey Building. So you can stop in at any time and ask for that information if you think it would be helpful. Another challenge, I think, is really feeling invisible. And this goes back to what I said, I think, about isolation in the beginning. I think when you're living with metastatic breast cancer, you often feel invisible, especially in comparison to all the other breast cancer patients, because so much of what is advertised. I'm thinking right now in particular of October being Breast Cancer Awareness Month, and I often hear from metastatic breast cancer patients they see on TV all the time, cure, survivors, do the walks, and it's hard when you don't feel like you fit into that category to not feel a little bit invisible. So again, I think finding other groups of people who understand what this is like helps you feel a little bit less invisible. I just put one of the websites that probably many of you are aware of, the Metastatic Breast Cancer Network, has a lot of online forums you can join if you're not someone that feels like an in-person group would work for you. You can establish an informal support group in your community. I know several metastatic patients who have done that because maybe you don't live locally and you want to be able to support other people living with this illness. And lastly, educating people about your illness and what the differences are in metastatic breast cancer, if that's something that feels comfortable to you, because I think it does help them to understand that it's not the same. People always tell me that they get approached by people who have had an early stage breast cancer diagnosis saying, I totally get what you're going through. And you're thinking, you don't get what I'm going through at all. And that's true. And so I think it's helpful to be able to educate them. Sometimes you don't want to because you're thinking, you know, I don't want to make them aware of what I wasn't aware of before. But educating other people, the important people in your life, I think about what this is like so that they really do get it's different. It's something that you're living with every day, and you may look completely normal, but you're dealing with metastatic breast cancer, and that's a life-threatening illness, and you're also on treatment forever. And that's something for people that's important, I think, for other people to understand so that they can be supporting you. And I think the last challenge, and this sort of ties into managing the long-term relationships, is really caregiver concerns. And I think that it's really challenging to be a caregiver, to be a spouse of someone who has metastatic breast cancer, because often all of the support is focused on the patient, and they're carrying a lot of additional stressors around, whether that's concrete stressors, like having to support you financially and support the family, to emotional stressors, wondering what's it going to be like if this person progresses or if their disease doesn't go in the way that I'm hoping it is. And then it can also be about the pressure that I think caregivers put on themselves and also sometimes on the patient to think positively. I'm sure many of you have heard positive thinking will do wonders. Make sure you have a positive attitude. And it's okay not to have a positive attitude all the time. There's no evidence to show that it makes your disease any worse. And I'm not saying you should be negative all the time, but I think it's okay if you don't want to put a smile on every day, especially when you're coming here. But the caregivers also feel that pressure, and it's important for them to have a place that's not you to go with that and to say that this really stinks, and it's hard for me to live with this every day. And I think, you know, sometimes that's an individual therapy. Sometimes that's a support group for them. We have a wonderful caregiver support group at Dana-Farber. Sometimes it's in an online forum, but really encouraging them to get support for themselves, because oftentimes they're so busy taking care of all the other things that are going on in their lives and in your life that they don't take the time to really get their own support. And it's so important for them to be, I think it was in the palliative care talk that, you know, in order for them to be able to support you, they need to be a whole person. And it's important for them to have their own resources for that. And lastly, I really wanted to end with a quote that I really like, and it's, you know, it's not hard to live through a day if you can live through a moment. And what creates despair is the imagination, which pretends there's a future and insists on predicting millions of moments, thousands of days, and so drains you they cannot live the moment at hand. And I think one of the ways that you'll get through this is by really being able to focus on the present. It's a lot easier said than done, but getting support to do that, I think, will make it easier. So thank you.